Hello and welcome to this Eureka webinar. My name is Paul Fanning and I'm Eureka's editor. Today's webinar is in association with Maxon and is entitled Motorised Implants in the Human Body. It will be presented by Matthew Dean, Medical Sales Engineer, Maxon, and I'll shortly be handing over to Matthew. But before I do, I'd just like to remind you that if you have any questions, please type them into the box at the right of the screen and we will try to answer them at the end. If we don't have time to answer your question, Maxon will try to answer it offline after the webinar. And with that, it's over to you, Matthew.
Okay. Hello, everyone, and thank you, Paul. Let's start. So this webinar is all about active motorized implants within the human body. And Maxon has a long tradition within the medical industry. And we think this is a topic which is, an interesting topic. So let's start with a nice picture of a Swiss lake and the Maxon factory nestled next to the Swiss lake. The collection of grey buildings just on the edge of the lake is the Maxon factory. Maxon has been there since it started in the early 60s and has grown ever since. A few facts and figures about Maxon, just over half a billion Swiss franc turnover, about 3,000 employees worldwide, and we make about 5 million drives a year. And we have significant investment in R&D, especially aimed at the medical industry. In fact, the large grey building you see next to or closest to the lake is a new building. Opened last year and is a result of a 30 million Swiss franc investment. And within that building, you'll find various clean rooms, and we call it the Medical Technology Center. So one thing which isn't mentioned in this slide, but I'd like to mention, is that out of the half a billion Swiss franc turnover, just under half of that comes from the medical industry. So although Maxon has a presence in aerospace and industrial and robotic industry, the biggest industry that we're involved in by far is medical. So let's move on. So how did it all start in terms of electromechanical implants? Well, it all started with what you're looking at in that picture, really, and that is a pacemaker. The story started with Mr. Larsson in Stockholm in Sweden in 1958. He was very unwell, Mr. Larsson. Put simply, his heart was beating around 28 times a minute when it should be beating closer to 70 times a minute. He was in good health, other than he had a major problem with his heart. And, he would die if something couldn't be done. Now, Mrs. Larsson, she found out about a piece of research that was done in a hospital in Stockholm, and she volunteered her husband to be the first guinea pig, to be the first recipient of a pacemaker to try and get his heart beating at the correct beat. The implant was made. Some interesting things about that implant is the epoxy that you can see encasing all the electrical components is in fact aldite. And the mold tool they used to mold the epoxy was in fact an old shoe polish tin, but it was exactly the right size, 55 mil in diameter and 16 mil thick. And it was implanted into Mr. Larsson in 1958, and it lasted 8 hours. After 8 hours, he had another version fitted, which lasted a week. And it was the start of a remarkable life for Mr. Larsson. He lived to be an old man. He lived to be 86 years old. And in his life, he had a total of 26 different pacemakers fitted. But the magic of this story really is that it shows what's possible when engineers and the medical profession collaborate. So that's how it all started in the late 50s. So now we're into medical devices now. So really, there's three different classes of medical device. Class 1, Class 2A, Class 2B, and Class 3. Anything which is implantable falls very much into Class 3, which is high risk and needs constant monitoring. Typical example of a Class 1 medical product would be your glasses or a stethoscope, something fairly mundane. Class 2, Class 2A, things like syringes, hearing aids, ultrasound machines, that sort of thing. And as you start going up pyramid of risk, you have to meet the much stricter requirements. Class 2B could be long time medical use, obviously sterilizable, surgical lasers, that sort of thing. And then anything implantable, we're right at the tip of the pyramid, which is Class 3. So now we've established that we're looking at Class 3 medical products, which is implantable. Who governs? Who are the regulatory authorities which really decide if your product, if you come up with an implantable product, is actually fit for use within the medical profession? And there are various regulatory authorities around the world, depending on where you live. FDA is based in the States and looks after American requirements. Swiss MedTech, CFDA, Asian regulatory authority, and these are the people that give you the green light for your product. And without the green light from them, you can't implant your product. Then below them, you have the medical manufacturer. There's one listed there, major one, Medtronic. And Maxon typically would work with the medical manufacturer to work on a suitable motor and drive system for the implantable device. There are various guidelines that you work with, ISO 9001, which we're all very familiar with. Then there's more standards which are based towards the medical sector, ISO 13485, which looks after the quality standards, and 60601, which is for general medical devices. What's key here is that the supplier, in this case Maxon, works very closely with the medical manufacturer in holding the hand, really, of getting the product approved through the regulatory authorities. So although it's just one slide, the actual work needed to satisfy these regulatory bodies can be significant and take a huge amount of investment and time, and in some cases can be a barrier to entry. So how do things really start? Well, they start from Maxon's viewpoint with often with a catalogue product. So Maxon has a catalogue full of motors, gearboxes, controllers, encoders, etc. And the basic requirements of what the motor needs to do in the implant would come from the manufacturer of the implant. And we would start with a catalog product. We would boil it down to maybe a modified version of the catalog product, maybe just to get some samples, so, you know, a proof of concept, that sort of thing. But then as the design goes through, it starts turning into a medical product. And what that really means is paperwork. The paperwork would control quality standards, processes, design considerations, product needs to be traceable, all the things that you would expect. But often projects start with the motor or some version of a motor from the catalogue. So we're now getting to the nitty-gritty, really. Active implants, typical applications. So when you're using a motor within the human body, the motor obviously gives you a rotary motion. And typically that rotary motion is used to drive some sort of pump. So when you're talking about pumps, you're looking at doing things with liquids. So maybe transfer a liquid from one part of the body to another. Dose a liquid, so the pump could be loaded with a drug, and that drug could be dosed directly into an organ. Or you could use the motor to increase the flow of a liquid. It could be blood. We'll come on to that a little bit later. You could dose a drug to simulate a body function or open and shut a valve. But basically, motors generally are used to drive pumps within the human body. So why would you want to put a pump inside the human body? Well, the biggest application is to help your heart. So we're all fitted with a pump within our bodies, which is the heart. The heart's job is to pump blood all over the body, to all the organs. And if you have a problem with your heart, it affects your whole body. And the heart, or problems with heart, is a significant reason for death and illness within humans. There's a few bullet points on that slide there. You'll see, you know, 1 in 5 adults will develop heart failure in their lifetime. So, you know, 20% of us is a significant statistic. The money that is invested in heart assist devices, you know, $100 billion spent a year looking at things to assist the heart. I mean, that is a significant sum of money. So any form of anything you can do to assist the heart, you can see you could have a massive impact on populations and the quality of life. So what does a typical heart assist device look like? Well, the most common is the heart catheter pump. So what you're looking at there is really a selection of tubes and anchoring devices for moving fluid around. But the clever bit is inside one of those tubes would be a very small motor with a small pump fitted to it that can help pump blood to take up the slack, really, of what the heart is failing to do. As we move to the middle section of the slide, the picture you're looking at there, labeled LVAD, that is a more invasive procedure to put the pumping device within the heart. It's more of a permanent fixture, is longer term, and it's kind of the next step, halfway house between a heart catheter pump and a full artificial heart. Maxon has significant experience in heart catheter pumps and also LVAD devices. Big attraction of the heart catheter pump is it's easily installed. You don't have to go through the rib cage, but generally it's for shorter time use, whereas the LVAD is a bit more permanent, more invasive, more of a procedure to put it in place, and it's designed for longer term use. So let's have a little look at the catheter implant heart assist device. So the large collection of tubes, the business end of all those tubes is actually implanted within the heart. The little device on the left would contain a brushless motor driving a small propeller within the housing, and the sprung little arms lock everything in place. So although it sounds quite simple, you've got a motor driving an impeller, there are some very special pieces of technology and requirements that go in to make that and design that, that enables it to live quite happily within your heart. And as I said before, sort of take up the slack of what your heart is failing to do. So the first thing you'll notice is that it's a very smooth surface. The blood flows around it, so things like outside temperature and the surface finish, etc., need to be very carefully controlled. But the OD of the whole device, you can see there, is 4 mil. So you know it's you're talking very small diameters in which to package motors and pumps, etc. So this slide really is what we're getting to here really is the laws of physics for the project. In no particular order, these points are listed here, but we'll just go through them and I'll pick out the ones which I think are absolutely key. Sterilizable, ETO, gamma, whatever sterilization method is adopted, that has to be built into the design to withstand it. You have to use the right materials, titanium for housings, for metal housings, etc., silicon cables, biocompatible lubrication adhesives, etc., sign to go without saying. Battery operated, so you know we all want to be mobile, we all want to be active, and that's no different for the people who are recipients of these types of devices. So, battery operated. External temperature of the implant, you're looking at sub 40 degrees. It's kind of obvious that has to be, but in terms of using motors to do things, you know, motors generally take in current and generate, you know, you've got coils, motor coils with current running through them, which, yeah, things get hot. So keeping things below 40 degrees is a challenge. How do you do it? Well, you use motors with the highest possible efficiency. I mean, it's the laws of physics. What you put in is what you get out. So electrical energy in equals the mechanical energy out, which is what you want. And any losses which you don't get in mechanical energy, you will get in temperature, typically. Maybe a little bit of noise, but mainly heat, which is your enemy. So using the highest possible efficiency motor is a must. Needs to be as small as possible. We don't have little sections inside us where it's waiting for a motor to be fitted, so any implant has to be tucked away inside your heart or near your heart. So having things as small as possible is a big plus. And you do that by using very high power density motors. So really, these few points here, you know, to do with efficiency, as small as possible, the highest power density, couple that with the next point, which is to do with generally you have one fixed optimized working point. So you design a motor to do one thing, and it does that one thing as well as the current technology enables you to do it. And it's those collection of four points really which is absolutely key when making an implant where you're using a motor. And that really is where the special motor technology that Maxon has, with its cordless windings and its general manufacturing capability and experience in the medical technology world, it's really those four points which set it aside. So we're now into more easily more manageable parts of the engineering project or requirements. sealing motor housings, using the right cables with strain relief. You imagine you have cables, the internal parts of your body move around, and cables need to be flexible, and they need to be, they need to have a degree of strain relief built into the product. Feed through, what we call feed through design. So this is how you get electrical cables from within the sealed implantable device to the outside of the body. Is a challenging area. We'll cover that in a bit. Lifetime could be short. Some implants are designed to lie, designed to have a life of a operation. So it could be a few hours, or you could be looking into the years. And another one, that the last little bullet point here is little or no blood damage on the surface in contact with the blood. What basically that is saying is that the outside of the implant, which is in contact with your blood and your body tissues, need to be prepared in a certain way that stops blood clots forming on the surface, but also within the pump. When you pump blood, you have to be very careful not to damage blood cells, and also have no little nooks and crannies for the blood to sit, which can lead to thrombosis. So they're the sort of general requirements of a motor that goes into an implant. The environment, so this is the production environment. You need certain clean rooms to build motors in, and also things like packaging. When the product leaves Maxon, it needs to be packaged in a way that often goes into a certain period, a short time of storage, and then straight to an operating theater. So everything has to be laid out in a ergonomic design, so the surgeon isn't wrestling with getting the bits out in the right order. It's all part of the general requirements when designing a motor and implantable product that goes into the human body. What materials are used? Anything metal in terms of housings, etc., typically is titanium. And why is it used? Well, it's light, it's strong. I mean, there's two very good reasons why it's used, but also you can get the right surface finishes on it, so the blood doesn't clot or stick to it. The downside of using titanium is it's expensive, and you have to know what you're doing when you're using it. It's not easily to manufacture components out of titanium. For electrical connections, gold is favoured. Gold widely being known and used for making electrical connections in demanding applications, whether it's space, aerospace, or whatever. Gold is, you can't beat gold, really. Glass, surprisingly. Glass can be used as a sealant. And it doesn't react with the body. We'll come on to that a little bit later. Silicon covering wires, etc. Very flexible, and biocompatible grades are available, which means it's quite happy living within the human body. The same considerations if you're using adhesives and if you're using lubrication. You have to be very careful when using lubrication and adhesives, and generally if the design allows you not to use them, then that is the preferred choice. So within a motor or a product or an implant using a motor, seals are often used to seal shafts. What you're trying to do is to keep what's inside the motor or the implant inside and what's in the outside world outside. So shaft seals, what you might do is you might use multiple shaft seals on the same shaft. You might use them back to front, so one seals one way and the other seal uses the other. But that's fairly typical. You can see that seal the rear of the body of the motor. Potting, for instance, is commonly used to add strain relief, but also as a type of seal. But what's really interesting on this slide is if you look at the top right-hand picture, the electrical feed-through. So this is, you're taking the electrical connections from inside the motor to the outside of the implant. And this typically is done with gold pins, and they're potted in glass. So we're all familiar with potting using epoxies, etc. But in this type of, in the world of implants, this is done using glass. The reason that glass is used is you get a very good connection, a very good seal between the gold pin and the glass. So that will work under high vacuum. So space applications, etc. might use this type of technology. But it's widely used inside the implants within the human body. The bottom right-hand side is showing what you can do is you can make the motor and maybe the pump or the implant, and then you can case the whole thing in a tube, and you can weld around the edges of the tube to make a seal, so it's hermetically sealed. They're just examples, really, of sealing the implant for use within the human body. So, building a motor, the type of environment that you need to build a motor ends up inside the human body. Typically, you would use clean rooms, GMPC, particle and hygiene monitored clean rooms. These are very demanding places to work. You go through a procedure in order to get into the clean room, and then you stay within the clean room for the building process, and then you exit. So if you have an issue that you need to leave, whether it be for hygiene reasons or whatever, or you've been feeling unwell, you have a cold example, then you can't, you have to stay out the clean room for a large portion of time. So it's very demanding on the staff that work in those types of environments. The picture that you're looking at there is class 8 clean room. So this is particle monitored. So often the motors that you're making are very small. And you just can't have particles. You can't have particles in there. Next picture. Okay, well, so, yeah, this is a very clean room. In fact, it's so clean, it's got nothing in it. But within the Maxon facility, we have clean rooms within clean rooms in order to manufacture Class 3 medical device. And that's our clean rooms live in on the first slide where I was showing you the factory, the new facility. This is actually a photo of the clean room being installed. So additional tools that you can use, that Maxon uses when looking at a new design of implants. Various simulations are used. Physical strength, dynamics, so you might want to look at the flow of a pump, electromagnetism simulations, all part of the design process. The reason that simulations are so key is that it can be very expensive to make initial samples. So to test a design in a simulation first is a great step to take, and especially in areas like electromagnetism, maxon is very, very strong. And often at the heart of the product is the electromagnetism circuit, and that really is where cutting edge of the use of magnets and coils, etc., is seen. So that these are powerful tools, which is a must for any part of the design. Then you go, once you have a design in place, there's a significant amount of testing that the product is put through. Now this would be in order to satisfy regulatory requirements. They may want to see test results. There may be certain tests that they want performed. Typical tests could be vacuum, putting the part in a high vacuum. What you're really doing there is testing seals and how hermetically sealed the product actually is. Sterilization, you might want to put the design through various cycles of sterilization to make sure that everything survives. Shock and vibration. You know, you don't want anything to be too delicate going into the human body. It's got to survive shipping. It's got to survive manufacturing processes, etc. And often part of the motor is obviously coupled to a pump. It's all part of the design. So you need to test the pump. Flow testing is key. Is the pump delivering the flow rates that you would expect? So, we come now to what the future might hold. Future fully artificial heart. I mean, there have been fully artificial hearts in the past, but they're generally large, it's a work in progress. So, I'm sure fully artificial hearts will become more and more available, should I say. One, you know, they're a work in progress, so kind of watch this space, really. The next point, I think, is more pressing, really. Prediction of heart problems. So at the minute, what happens is that someone who is ill and displaying symptoms of a weak heart will go to their doctor, they'll get a diagnosis. The diagnosis could lead to an implant of some description, pacemaker or something else. And so what you're doing is you're taking someone who is essentially ill and trying to improve their quality of life. What I think will happen in the years to come is that doctors will be able to predict if you are likely to have a problem with your heart. And then you could maybe get some implant that helps the heart, but it doesn't, it stops you having the serious symptoms that you get when you have a problem with your heart. So you're solving the problem before prevention, that's the word, prevention, rather than trying to cure it. So that, I think, is we're not too far off from that. As implantable devices become smaller and more widely accepted, then people will have them to try and stop them getting any symptoms at all. In the future, implantable devices being implanted by surgical robots. There are surgical robots out there at the minute, but they're improving all the time. And I don't think we're that long before surgical procedures are carried out purely by surgical robots. Maybe another topic for a webinar in the future. The same goes for fully motorized limbs. prosthetics, feet, hands, etc. Yeah, so all an area of sort of great excitement, really, as things get smaller and that they are what the future holds, I think. So here endeth the PowerPoint, and I think Paul, are you there, Paul?
I am indeed. Yes, thank you very much, Matthew. We have some questions for you. So the first one is, what is the longest time a motor has been in the human body?
Well, that is a good question. You know, at the start of the of active implants, you know, the first one, as I said earlier, was about 8 hours. And then the second one was a week. It lasted, and it's just progressively grown from there. So now you could be looking at years. So anyway, you know, 5 years onwards is a typical time for a long-term implant to be within the body.
Okay. You touched on this. What materials do we use in implantable applications?
Okay. Typically, obviously, titanium, silicon, glass, gold, etc. That was covered in the presentation. But what can be particularly challenging when using whatever material you've decided to use is all the processes that material goes through during the manufacturing process. So as it goes through from one bit of tooling to another bit of tooling, there may be some cleaning steps, there may be some additional finishing steps that are used, and the material that you use has to be able to not only survive it, but be totally unaffected by it. So yeah, that's use of materials in implants is a big subject, and I've just given a brief overview, really, of typical materials that we use.
And a related question: how do you make a sterilizable motor?
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, making a sterilizer, the first question you have to ask yourself is, what sort of sterilization process does the motor need to go through? Steam, ETO, gas, gamma radiation, etc. And depending on what type of sterilization you're using depends on what materials and what sort of seals, etc., are needed within the motor. So it could be temperature. You could be using high temperature to do it. So you would need electrical components and wiring, etc., that can all withstand it. So there's a number of tricks up the sleeve, starting with seals, potting, encasing it, hermetically sealing it within titanium cases, that sort of thing. So, yeah, there's more than one way to do it. But the first question you ask is, what sterilization process are you going to use?
What happens if a motor coil fails?
Well, that's a good question. So typically, the motors that we're talking about in implants are brushless motors. So they have three phases. If one of the phases fails, then obviously you have a misfunctioning motor. So what we can do is that we can build into the motor redundant coils. So if a motor coil phase fails for whatever reason, then we can either switch on an alternative coil, or in some cases we can wind two motors within the same winding. So you switch either on a coil or on a completely new set of coils. So you have redundancy in the motor, and that's done from building additional coils into the motor windings.
Okay, and I think we've got time for just one more, which is, how do you make the motor and pump as one unit?
Okay, so traditionally what you would do is you would take a motor and you would couple it to whatever needs turning. In this case, we're talking about a pump. Where we're talking about the larger type LVAD heart assist pumps, what you would do is that you would build the pump rotor. You would make that part of the motor rotor. So what you do is you start merging two separate components together. And what that does is it starts making things smaller and less components, simpler, but you have to be very, very good with packaging and the design. And that comes from, Maxon engineers with experience who understand pumps, but also, more importantly, motors, and they start building hybrid motors, which, half motor, half pump. So that's kind of how we do it.
Okay. Thank you very much. So, it just falls to me to say thank you very much to our audience, and thank you very much, Matthew. Goodbye.
Okay, thank you, everyone, and goodbye.